first speaker after lunch. His name is Bruce Chamoff. He's been a web developer for 20 years. And he's been working with WordPress themes and plugins for about 9 years. That's impressive. He's developed over 100 custom WordPress plugins. He's done over 50 WordPress themes for the likes of Fortune 500 companies. He keeps himself in shape by jogging. We just had that on his bio, but I know that about. Also, is a musician, so you may get some musical plugin development stuff today. Anyway, I'm going to let Bruce take it away. We're going to have about 5 to 10 minutes of Q&A after he gets finished. So everybody give a big round of applause for Bruce.
Thank you, Robert. So I just want to start off with a question for everybody. How many people in this room, show of hands, are PHP developers that have not yet developed a plugin? Okay, so about half the room, that's great. Okay, good. Well, what I'm going to do in this particular session is I'm only going to lecture from these PowerPoint slides for about 15 minutes, and I'll get into the coding. So we're going to actually build a plugin from scratch. We're also going to change the Hello Dolly plugin to be more modern. How many people like Hello Dolly? How many people disable it so you should install WordPress? Okay. Well, I'll tell you quickly, Hello Dolly is a song that was made popular by, I don't remember who the artist was, it was 1955. There was an album from Louis Armstrong. Well, Louis Armstrong didn't create, a lot of people think that. He had an album called Hello Dolly. But we're going to change those lyrics to something more modern, okay? For the people who are 40 years old and older, we can substitute it with a Billy Joel song. How's that? Okay. And for the kids in the room, you want to do a Justin Bieber song? So what? Just do it. Fine. So I'm going to give you a very quick bio on me. I've been developing WordPress for 9 years. In that time, I experimented with Drupal and Joomla. I got good at those as well, but WordPress pretty much has became my expertise. And I love teaching people. I love speaking publicly. The more the merrier. And I'm a musician, so I have no problem. If Robert, before Robert said he might tell some jokes, if he doesn't, I might. All right, so let's get into what a plugin is. So a plugin is at least one PHP script. If you can write PHP, you can write plugins, okay? And it's really that simple. Of course, you may have seen some of the really big plugins like WooCommerce and BuddyPress and some of those other ones, right? But, and those are a lot of files. Those include HTML and CSS and some jQuery and AngularJS and whatever. But you can build a really good plugin with just one file, and that's PHP. Okay, so basically, this morning, Boone was speaking about the core. If you were in the first session this morning, okay, you're speaking about the core, who's a core contributor. What happens is when you install WordPress, or when anybody installs WordPress, you get the core. What is the core? It's three folders. Okay, it's WP includes, WP admin, and WP content. And a couple of files on the root, right? Well, we really cannot change the core. We call it hacking the core. But WP content folder, we're allowed to change as much as we want. And that's where our plugins are stored. If you haven't looked under the hood as how plugins are structured, we will in the next half hour. And as I said before, plugins contain one PHP file, or it can contain CSS, jQuery, HTML, any type of JavaScript. And like I said, you can put as many files as you want. And the way plugins are structured, very simple. We have a hook, and we have a callback function. We're going to look very heavily at the hooks in the next couple of minutes. Because without hooks, WordPress has no idea what to do with the plugin. The callback function, that's exactly where all of our PHP code goes. Why do we need plugins? Well, as I said, I want to prevent hacking the core. What happens is I speak to a lot of WordPress developers that like to change WordPress in some way, shape, or form. So what do? They go into WP Admin, they change a couple of PHP files there. They go into WP Includes, they change a few files there. And then the person using WordPress updates WordPress. What happens? Code is gone. Okay, plugins are like, they're like a traffic cop. They protect your code from all the installation changes. Because once WordPress, and we know that WordPress gets updated like every week, right? There's like a new version, and there's always that message to update WordPress. The code gets changed, it gets erased, it gets rewritten, and when they do it manually, they do it through the link, you can lose your code. So plugins are the way to actually prevent that from happening, prevent you from losing your code. And I just said the same thing, protect the code from updates.
That's okay.
Now, also, what WordPress plugins do is they extend the basic functionality, okay? That's the key word, extend, okay? It takes WordPress and does something completely out of the box. When you install BuddyPress is extending WordPress to make it a social network. When you install Yoast, it's extending WordPress to give you SEO capabilities, right? When you install WooCommerce, it extends WordPress to have e-commerce. When you build a plugin, you have to ask yourself, what is your plugin going to extend? What is it going to do? And here's the big red words. Now, here's what I want you guys to do. Hack the core is when we change the main installation. And again, I've talked to a lot of programmers who have actually hacked the core. Okay? So I'm going to wake you guys up. I know we just ate. We just had lunch. A lot of people are kind of tired from eating. So here's what we're going to do. On the count of three, I want us all in this room to yell those four red words. And I want you guys to be so loud. And I want them to hear you in the next room, in the user track. Ready? One, two, three.
Don't hack the core.
I can hear one person. Just again. One, two, three.
Don't hack the core.
Good. So next time you try to hack the core and you skip doing a plugin, you know you yelled at me. You yelled at somebody. You yelled at me. So don't hack the core. Your plugins are a way of not doing it. Or actually doing it. Okay. What is the WordPress core? I explained it before. It's WP Includes, WP Admin, all the files on the root, and the only other folder is WP Content. Okay? There is one file. There's one file in the root that we are allowed to change. What is that file? Say a letter? WP config, that's right. We need WP config because we need to tell WordPress mainly our database connections, right? But if you're installing WordPress through Bluehost or GoDaddy, that's all done for you behind the scenes, right? But we're allowed to touch that one file. Maybe HT assets. But that's about it. Anything else that we touch is through WP content. Okay? That's, I don't really know if they call that part of the core, but it's, you're not supposed to touch the core and you're allowed to touch that folder. So I'm assuming that that's not part of the core. This is basically what it looks like. So this is how it looks underneath the hood. Okay? So under the hood we have WP content. Then our next folder are plugins. And if you're developing a theme, themes also. Okay? Anything you can change, you can extend WordPress, goes right under this folder right here. And then you create a folder for your own plugin. But that part is not exactly,
excuse me,
that's optional. Because Hello Dolly is not under a big folder, it's just hello.php. So you can actually build a plugin without creating that last folder. If you do use the folder, then of course you can put all the code in there, including JavaScript, HTML, and if you have images. And basically you'll be calling in all of those files through your plugin. Okay, so now, how do you name a plugin? Like I said, it starts off with one PHP file, at least. Okay, if we store it in the WP plugins directory, and examples are what I have down here. If you want to create a plugin that will make a breakfast, Fine. You can call it Make Breakfast, okay? Or you can have makebreakfast.php. Don't laugh. They got a plugin for everything. You know that. Okay. And I'm not a very big planner, okay? I know a lot of people tell you we should be planning things, okay? Sometimes I think planning takes too long, it wastes a lot of time. But when you do create a plugin, you do have to ask yourself a couple of questions. Who is going to use your plugin? Is it going to be an admin on the back end? Is it going to be a user that comes and Google your website and just, you know, is it somebody who's a writer? What user role are they going to have? When is your plugin going to run? Is it going to run in the back end when somebody logs in, when somebody logs out, when somebody's saving, when a writer's saving a blog post? Okay. When is, it means anything that happens at any time in the WordPress load process. There's even, when I say when, there's even a hook, which we'll get into soon, called init. Init is basically when WordPress starts running. Admin-init, or admin underscore init, is when the admin starts running. So when do you want your plugin to start running? And of course, where is it going to run? Is it going to run in a blog post? Is it going to run on a page? It's going to be in the editor, in the back end, when the writer is writing something. It could be anywhere. And of course, the other two questions are, what will execute? That's the PHP code that you're going to write. And how will it execute? That's it. I think that's entirely the way to plan a plugin. It doesn't need to get any more complex than that. And I will have this PowerPoint slide up on the web, and I'll put it on Twitter so you can download it. Now we get into the good part of it. So a lot of people ask me, what is the architecture of a plugin? It's really just three pieces. You've got the header, which is a bunch of PHP lines, it's comments. And we know that when we're programmers and we comment code out, it's supposed to be ignored, but WordPress doesn't ignore your comments. Put those comments in your plugin file, WordPress will read that. And that's where it actually shows up when people are loading the plugin, when they're activating it. The next part is the hook. Now the hook, we're going to get into some detail because the hook is very important. Drupal also has hooks. Drupal doesn't, but if you, you know, get into other content management systems, you need to get used to hooks because the hook will answer the first three questions in the plan. So going back to the plan, who, when, and where. That's what the hook will do. Okay? And the last part of it is the callback function. Basically, what's happening is we have, if you look at number two, we have two types of hooks, if I'll get into it. The filter hook will change your blog post or change your page in some way. Okay? The hook name is given to us by WordPress. There are hundreds of hooks. You only need to use a few. But a good plugin developer will know exactly what hook to use. And there's a reference. I'll give you that link in a minute. And you can actually look up a hook and what the name of it is and what it does on the WordPress hook reference, right on WordPress.org. The second part of that is the callback function, which basically has to match your next function. Because that callback function is where all your PHP is going to get executed. Okay, so when the hook tells WordPress when, where, for who to run. The callback function is going to tell WordPress what to do. And that's where you start having fun as a developer. Because, hey, it's just PHP. So more about hooks. There are two types of hooks. There are actions and filters. Action does something. It does something to WordPress. And I'll get into some examples in a minute. Filter hooks will change the code, okay? I had a client that literally blogged about 5 to 10 times a day. And by the time I met this client, they had something like 3,000 blog posts. Then she started a Facebook page. She actually went into all the blog posts and she went right at the bottom and said, hey, this is my new Facebook page. Well, you know what? I don't know about you guys, but I can't edit 3,000 blog posts. If I edit 5 of them, I'll be burnt out already. So with a filter hook, I can tell WordPress to put that announcement at the end of every blog post. I don't have to edit any of them. Would you rather do that? Okay. Now, hosts are a necessary part of WordPress because they instruct WordPress what to do. And again, I'm just reiterating that they tell WordPress when, where, for whom to run. Themes also use hosts as well. So for those of us who build themes in the functions.php file, you can use the same hooks and themes as you do in plugins. Themes are actually a little harder to develop than plugins. Why is that? Tell me. Why are themes a little more, they're a little more complex than plugins? Why? Okay, I got critics. Because themes, you always have to deal with HTML, CSS, some form of JavaScript. Is it gonna be responsive? Is it gonna show up, you know, looking well on iPad? An iPhone and all the mobile devices. Plugins, you don't really have to worry too much about that. You might add some HTML and CSS, but it's not necessary. It just depends on what you want your plugin to do. And again, the interesting fact, number 5, is that Drupal also uses hooks. Now, if you want to take a picture of this slide right here, that URL, those URLs are your hook references. So, I see a lot of smartphones coming out, that's cool. Or if you have laptops, you can just type this in and they'll give you the list of all the hooks. And trust me, there's a lot of them. Don't get overwhelmed. And here are some of my favorite hooks. I use these a lot. Okay, so admin menu, if you have the menu on the side, okay, when you install a plugin and all that new link comes, that is what the admin does. It creates a submenu item for you. Going down, I mentioned init, I mentioned admin init. Some of the other ones are edit user profile, like right, I think about the 8th one down. So when a user changes something, you can have your plugin do something. Maybe you are an admin, okay? And your plugin is going to use this edit user profile hook and send you an email every time a user changes something about their profile. It's a really good one. I use that one a lot. Going down to the 6th one, WP OnCue Scripts. I know a lot of us have heard of this one. If you have JavaScript or CSS, this is the way your plugin will load. It will load those files. And a lot of people have built child themes. Okay, child themes used to import CSS from the parent, but now we don't even do that. We use this hook called WP OnCue Scripts. I think everybody's using JavaScript nowadays. Okay, so you really need to get good at that particular hook. Now that's the action hooks. Filter hooks. The first one down is the content. That one I use all the time. That is the one in my example with the 3,000 blog posts. All you need to do is use this hook, the content, you call in the content of the blog post or the page, and you just concatenate that new URL right to the bottom. So whenever that person is typing, it's going to concatenate some HTML, and it's going to say, hey, visit my, or like my new Facebook page, or like follow me on Twitter. It's very cool, and I use that one a lot. Scrolling down to the 3rd one, body class, if you have a new CSS class, and you want to add some CSS to the body, use body class. I mean, let me tell you, this is something like, what, 20? There are hundreds. And you just have to take the time, go through that list, and you know, this URL over here at the bottom. Okay, you have your actions and your filters, and just see what they do. And in no time, you'll be a hook expert. So some real quick announcements, examples, excuse me. So if I want to announce my new Facebook page, I just give you this example at the end of every blog post. That's when it's going to, that's where it's going to run. Who for any public user, and I'm going to use the content. To greet an admin. Okay, if an admin logs in, or a writer logs in, I'm going to say, hey, welcome to my website. Thank you for writing for us. I can create a plugin that will welcome them to the back end. Edit user profile, I just went over that one. WP OnCue Scripts, I just went through that one as well. And these are some examples. Now, any questions about the hooks? Everybody's got hooks down. Are we falling asleep because we ate too much? Enjoyed our lunch? All right. Callback function is the easy part. That's where all the PHP goes. And a lot of people raise their hands when I said, when I asked the question, who here is a PHP programmer and has not built a plugin yet? Well, you have your PHP. It goes right to your callback function. And we're going to see more examples about that in a little while. Now, I mentioned all this. Number five, depending on the hook to call the function, you can set any number of parameters. The content that I just mentioned actually has a variable as a parameter called $content. That is whatever blog post or the page is feeding into that hook right now. And you can use that content and concatenate whatever you want. And then you return that variable right back through the function and it changes just like that. I hope making plugin development a little bit easier for everybody. Am I?
Yes.
All right. Come on, Rachel, let's do it. Can you hear you? You haven't seen anything yet. We're gonna turn Hello Dolly into It's Still Rock and Roll to Me. Okay. And because you are typing in PHP, you're also using APIs. WordPress has about 15 of them. I use about 6 of them. And some of these are pretty obvious if we have used WordPress a couple of often. We have the metadata, which are really just custom fields when you have a post. The theme customization API is that new customizer that we've had since, I think it was 4.2. Shortcode API, we all, most of us use shortcodes. I write shortcodes constantly. And shortcodes are very cool. And of course, widgets. Everybody who has used WordPress, those are the widgets. And there are a lot more APIs. But these are pretty much the ones I use all the time. And really, that's it. Before we get into coding, I just want to go through the steps. So we're going to open up a text editor. What text editor do you use when you're developing? Right? Andrea, I don't know if he's in here, but he just used PHP Storm. Right? He had a session on that. I use Notepad++. I also use Edit+. BB Edit, if you're on the Mac. Notepad, of course. Open up a file. We're going to do all this in a minute. Add the PHP directive, write your header, write your hook, write your callback function, add whatever supporting files you want, and you save it, and then you go ahead and you activate it, and you're good to go. Clear enough, right? Okay, excellent. Now, the reason I'm asking is because a lot of people say, whoa, plugins, those are really hard to build. I said, yeah, well, you know what, themes are even harder. So you can build a theme, you can build a plugin. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to actually make that plugin. We're going to add the content. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this code and put it into Notepad++. And I did this same, session back in April at WordCamp Jacksonville. And someone said to me, you know, if I were you, I would re-record the coding of this plugin. I said, why? Because you might make an error in front of everybody, would you be embarrassed? I said, no, we're developers! We make error messages! We're okay with that. Error messages, there's nothing wrong with error messages. There's nothing wrong with bugs. You know what? They're not the enemy. They're not something to fear. They are our friends. They're telling us there's something that's wrong with the code and you gotta fix it. But anyway, I did take a precaution. I typed it out anyway. So, but if I get an error message, fine, we'll fix it. So let me go ahead, let me open up my text editor. And I'm just going to just code and without talking, and you can just watch me. And I'll explain it in. Switch this. Oh, okay. we got the code. Here we go. I think it's the actual screen here itself, so I'll explain it though.
You mean the text size bigger?
So let's see if we can get this thing working. So basically, I'm keeping it very simple. So the plugin name is what's going to show up in my plugin list, obviously not activated. And then of course, add filter, I have the, I have the content, I'm changing the content, and then I have my callback function, and that's change content, which has to, these two have to equal. I'm passing in the parameter of the content, and I'm returning the content, and I did not concatenate. And that should do it. So now I should see an H1 tag saying I want my WC NYC. Of course, this is not going on Twitter right now, but let's go ahead, let's save this. See this, I'm going to see if I can blow this up a little bit. If I can't, I apologize for that. So right now I'm in my WordPress 4 on my local host, okay, I'm using WAN. Now, go to WP content, go into plugins, and that's where I'm going to keep it. So I'm going to just call it change, just like that. Of course, this doesn't describe anything very well, but I'll go ahead and do that. Now, let's go ahead and go into our installation, go right into our plugin list. And there it is right here, fixed content. Can you see that? Do I need to make it bigger?
Yeah.
Okay. So let me make it bigger. There we go. So now it's fixed content, and of course my description is Hello WordCamp NYC. And if I put in the author URI, that would appear down here under the version. I'm just keeping it simple because we don't have a lot of time. Now I'm going to activate this. If I have no errors, it'll activate without an error. But I got an error. We're programmers, right? We're not worried about errors, are we?
Semicolon.
Here we go. Let's go ahead and click the activate link one more time so those error messages go away. Good. It is activated. Now, let's go ahead and let's look at some of our blog posts. This is the spore, by the way, the spore theme. Now, I will click on any one of these. And there, well, let's see. Okay, you can see I was experimenting with this a lot, right? Okay. Not sure exactly what happened here, but let's figure it out. And if I don't specify a post or a page, then of course it will use any post type. Okay, so it didn't show up. Let's go look and find out why. I'll go to my cheat sheet here. But I doubt myself. It's okay, let me look at it right here. Well, it looks like everything is okay. I don't know exactly what happened here, but I'm just going to show you that basically what it should be doing is it should be taking that content and it should be able to turn it. Maybe a reference, but I'm not going to troubleshoot it now, but I can tell you that some bug I have here, I'm going to ignore for the moment, but this is pretty much a simple plugin. It's pretty much how it works. So I don't have this code also in the PowerPoint slides here as well. And it's, well, it did work in Jacksonville. So anyway.
Can you close your page before the page feedback?
No.
Well, we should. Well, let's go ahead.
I will.
No, I didn't do it, but we'll figure it out. Okay, it's not showing, but I won't worry about it for now, but I can tell you that this is a different site than I used. But either way, I will put this up on Twitter, and I'll give you the link if you can try to code yourself. But what we're going to do now is we're going to move on to Hello Dolly and change that. So what I'm going to do right now, I'm going to open up hello.php. And here is your Hello Dolly plugin. So what happens here is the way this works is we're looking for the actual hooks, okay? So we can search for add underscore, because add underscore is where all the actions happen. Now, looking here is the very last line is admin-head. That means that something is going to happen in the head section of the admin. And then, of course, we have our callback function, and you can see that my edit++ is also found it right here. Now, what we're doing is it's going to echo this CSS. And we can change the CSS any way we want. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go back and I'm going to disable Hello Dolly, because otherwise I will have a PHP error where the function is already declared. So, first thing is, okay, it's already deactivated. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to save this to another file. So we're just going to call it rock and roll. So now we have a plugin called rock and roll. And what we're going to do is we have this callback function. We can change the CSS any way we want. And then, of course, we have admin notices. So admin notice is going to call another callback function called Hello Dolly. And then that's going to have an internal function called Hello Dolly get lyric. And it's going to echo whatever variable gets returned through this function. And really, that's right here, Hello Dolly get lyric. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put in, it's still rock and roll to me from Billy Joel.
Billy Jolly.
Going to, now we have a couple of single quotes here that might break it. So let's go ahead, let's change this plugin name to Still Rock and Roll Me. And of course, we'll just keep rest of it. So let's go ahead and save that. Go back to our plugin list. And let's reload. And there it is, it's still rock and roll to me. Let me go ahead and fix those capitalization issues right there. And reload. Okay, so now we have it still rock and roll to me. If I have no bugs and no single posts don't give us a problem, it should activate with no error. And of course, we got some stars. Now, I didn't change anything other than the lyrics, right? So, there you go. Okay, so now let's go ahead. So we're going to activate it. So I've got a problem. I'm going to keep this simple. So let's try this one more time. We'll activate it. Now it's activated, and you see right up here at the very top, it says it's still rocking over me. Now, if I wanted to, I could go ahead and change that CSS in the admin head hook. So we're in Dolly CSS. We can maybe give this a nice big font size. It's 11 points. Let's make it really big. Let's make it like 51 points. Give it a nice color. Yeah, that's what you want the writers to see, right? Make it red. I'm not using hex, I know that. And let's reload. There you go. So I just changed Hello Dolly. So whatever song you like, you want to reinstall Hello Dolly, change the lyrics, you go right ahead and do it. My 13-year-old daughter wants me to do a Justin Bieber song. I said, no way. I said, you can listen to, my daddy likes classic rock, right? Led Zeppelin. So really, that's how you can do it. And really, in a nutshell, that is plugin development. I'm done. Thank you. Thank you. And what, do you have any questions?
Right here. So when you are working in a plugin that is more than one PHP file, is there a way that you like to organize your code, or are there boilerplates that you use to start from?
Well, like I was saying before, you can use a folder. So if you're in WP content and then plugins, the best thing to do is like what I was doing just now with the little Joel song, is I don't have a folder, but you can make a folder, and then all of your PHP files will go in there.
So do you have like a preferred way to organize all those files then, like separate your admin from your content, or?
I think for best practices, it's, I don't think there is a best practice on that. That's probably just the personal preferences of the developer.
And have you used any boilerplates yourself at all?
I do not use boilerplates. I know there are some out there, but I prefer to actually do the coding from scratch. But then again, I've developed so many plugins that I'm using my own plugins as my boilerplate. Any other questions? Yes?
Do you
have
anything that
you would
add as far as
unit testing? Turn the lights on. I'm sorry, say that again.
Do you have any preferences or strategies that you would apply
to unit testing? When it comes to unit testing, there are several plugins that are available, and I have not done unit testing on some of these plugins because I usually have a tester who works with me and who has her own test, you know, testing methods. So it's, I think she uses unit testing, she does some QA, she does some regression testing, and so forth. Next
one. Maybe it's more advanced, but I believe you are scoring stuff, like, you know, preferences or
Well, usually it depends on what PHP file you're using. If I store variables, normally I'll keep it inside a callback function, so that data does not leak into other plugins. You can use variables and call it the global keyword to your function if you want to do that. And by the way, the plugins and the themes work exactly, they work well with the main installation of WordPress. So if there's a variable that's in the core somewhere, you can retrieve that into your plugin. That gets your question. Okay. Any more questions? Yes, ma'am.
If you find a plugin that does most of what you want to do, but you need to edit parts of it, I know if it's a theme, you would create a child theme. Is there any way that you would do something similar so that if that plugin gets updated, you don't get most of it?
That's a great question. I actually had that planned to talk about it, but we're limited in time. So the question was, if we download a plugin from another developer and we want to change or edit that plugin in some way, but we don't want to get our changes overwritten because if the plugin developer, the main plugin developer, updates the code, we lose our changes, like back in the core, right? So just like I did with the Hello Dolly, what if Hello Dolly gets updated? I took Hello Dolly and I saved it as rockandroll.php. So there's no such thing as a child plugin, like we have child themes. So the way that we can prevent the overwriting is just take the same file or the same folder and make a duplicate and start making your changes. Once you do that, the original developer cannot touch that folder that you created. That.
Yeah, so then you would just kind of keep an eye on it and if you have problems, you see if maybe you fix something that you never had before.
Well, the thing is that if you create another plugin, you're no longer connected to the main plugin. Unlike a child theme, where if the parent theme gets updated, your child theme gets updated along with it. But there's no, as far as I can tell, there's no such thing as, you know, once you create, it's disconnected pretty much from the parent plugin or the copy, the original plugin. Yes?
One thing that you can do with many plugins is they'll have hooks and filters and you can hook into the existing plugin with a sub-plugin. That's literally how you can have all those add-ons for things like WooCommerce and easy digital downloads and project them. Many plugins will let you do that, and if not, you can always ask the developer if they can make things simpler. So if you just want to change the action to not have Jetpack's connect form show up on all of your custom post types, there's a way that you can configure it to do that using your own 2 lines of code and work for it. So just talking to developers and saying what they're trying to do, they'll often show you how to do it without having to form a plugin to make your own.
Well, that's a good point, Mika. Take it, right? Okay. Well, I don't like doing that for one reason. I mean, yes, you can do that. WooCommerce, they create their own add-ons because they're WooCommerce. But you got to be careful when you create a sub-plugin that's something else's plugin because of security reasons. How many times have you heard that, oh, you must update that plugin because it has a security hole? Right, you hear that all, I hear that all the time. So I'm a little worried that some developers don't really worry too much about security and then WordPress site gets hacked. So you can do that. That's a good point, Nika. Very good point. I personally don't do that. So it's up to everybody. So, well, thank you very much, everybody. Enjoy the rest of WordPress.